Paul Shankman headed south into the area known as Missouri's Lead Belt. Now, today, mostly we hear about the environmental issues, but lead mining has played a huge role in this state's history. And with Missouri's bicentennial coming up, people might be putting this place on their to-do list.
From a distance, it looks like the sort of place you'd want to avoid. But every year, thousands passing by on Highway 32 in Park Hills feel these woe-begone buildings beckoning them to come closer and explore the Missouri Mines State Historic Site. A place frozen in time, frozen by time.
This is not just an old mining district, it's one of the great mining districts of the world.
There are lots of minerals and metals underground here, but the one that built the towns and fed the families of southeastern Missouri was lead. So it's no wonder the state's mining museum was established in the foothills of the Ozark Mountains, close to the towns of Leadwood, Leadington, and Bonterre, which is French for good ground.
This diorama shows the very earliest mining here.
In his younger days, Art Hebrink did a little mining himself, but most of his life has been spent working for the state as a geologist and an educator. So in 1993, when the park system needed someone rock solid to run the mining museum, Art got the job. It has been 26 years of heavy lifting.
Most people are in the dark, absolutely. I mean, it's very frustrating to me because I know how important this is and how large this is and how it compares with other mining in the rest of the country. This is mind-boggling large.
The Lead Belt lies in the foothills of the Ozark Mountains, within 65 miles of St. Louis.
Missouri has been the nation's leading producer of lead for more than 100 years. Lead mining here goes back more than 300 years. And this museum celebrates that long history with a collection of curious minerals and a gallery of equipment used by the miners hired to get the lead out.
This is an electric locomotive. This machine is called the St. Joe Shovel. The drilling machine there, that revolutionized mining everywhere in the world.
Is this the real thing or is this a replica?
It's the real thing. All of this stuff's the real thing.
So where did all this stuff come from? Well, right here. The Missouri Mines State Historic Site used to be the Federal Lead Company. They started mining here in 1907 until they were bought by the St. Joseph Lead Company in 1923.
Arriving at the mine, the men changed to their working clothes in change houses.
The buildings that were here then are still here now, but the men are long gone because the lead is long gone. The depleted St. Joe mine closed in 1972. 4 years later, the company donated the land and its 150,000 square feet of rusty, hobbled buildings to the state park system. 12 years after that, the site opened to the public, though visitors are only allowed to view the buildings from the outside.
People really like this old rusty stuff.
Yeah, they like the ghost town, kind of the ghost town appearance is what they like about it. And the soft colors. I mean, we get artists and photographers, you know, and they go into terror mode if you start talking about painting all these buildings with silver paint or gray paint or something, because these are nice, warm, soft colors that everybody likes. I've had people say, why did you put this mine in this beautiful part of the Ozarks? Why don't you have your mine out in Kansas somewhere, someplace like that? It's like, duh, you know, I mean, ore deposits are where ore deposits are. They're very rare things, that's where you have to get that metal.
At its zenith, the St. Joe mine was 13 miles long and 5 miles wide. So big, it had 15 entrances. And so deep, a few spots could hold a building 30 stories tall. The floor of the mine was covered with 300 miles of railroad track, used to get the men to the ore and the ore to the surface. The locomotives were powered by trolley wires, driven by men better equipped for the job than me.
Well, you can put on the hat first. The light switches on there work. So there's your tail lights, headlights. The green button's the horn. And this is what makes it go. Grab this and pull it that. We're not gonna go anywhere, of course. Wow, you just went from like 0 to 10 miles an hour in one or 2 seconds. Okay, you're trained. You could submit for some pay, you won't get any, you're like a trainee.
The men who did this work for real were paid really well, with plenty of opportunities for bonuses.
This is the money job. The guy operating this shovel is filling ore cars. Now we're up to 2.7 ton ore cars. This guy had to fill 40 of those in an 8-hour shift. My retirees tell me anybody any good with this machine could fill 80 or 100 in a day. So way over bonus. And I have one old gentleman who gets me aside every year. We have an open house in September to remind me that he holds the company record on this job at 203 in one day.
Along with the monetary incentive, the workers at St. Joe wanted to do good things for the company because the company did good things for them. St. Joe Lead built many of their homes, nice ones, and their hospital, their first bowling alley, their first golf course, a YMCA, a theater, and equipment for local fire departments to keep it all standing. And then there is the Lake of the Ozarks, formed by the creation of Bagnell Dam, built to meet the mining industry's need for more electricity.
Listening to retirees, their number one thing that I hear about is the company carried all the employees through the Depression. They didn't lay people off, and they weren't selling enough lead to do that. Everybody knew they borrowed $10 million bank loans, and nobody will ever forget that.
At its peak, the St. Joe Lead Mine employed about 4,500 people. Most years, about 6,500 visit the museum.
You can depend on a bunch of people here late Saturday and late Sunday. These are people from St. Louis who are at Johnson Shut-Ins or Elephant Rocks, and as on their way, they see these buildings and say, whoa, what is that? We'll stop there on the way home.
That one.
I know, ain't that neat? It's pretty.
It's freaking awesome. Like, I had no idea. Like, it's super awesome.
He seems very excited about this.
Yeah, he loves rocks. Like, I'm surprised he hasn't thrown some off the shelves yet.
That one's cool too.
Have you had offers to use this as some sort of a movie set?
A few, not any great number of them. And the ones I remember early on, they wanted to do some kind of war movie and they were gonna blow the place up. We take a pass if they wanna blow our buildings up.
Though lead is no longer used in most countries to make paint or gasoline, it is still needed to make other things like car batteries. So a half dozen mines are still operating in Missouri. But in the part of the state known as the Old Lead Belt District, most of what is still visible from a once mighty industry are the chat piles it left behind, at one time considered symbols of prosperity, and later as reminders of the environmental trade-offs that come from rearranging the earth. But that part of the story is not really part of this place. They prefer to stick to the used-to-bes and accentuate the positive. And for Art Hebrink, there is nothing that excites him more than drilling down on Missouri's leaded past.
People come in and they don't have really very high expectations, but they come inside and it's like, wow, this is really cool, you know, this is neater than I thought.
That's pretty.
So it's a thrill to me to see their eyes light up and learn all these things they didn't know about their state.
That one's cool.